गुड आफ्टरनून फ्रेंड्स. सो लेक्चर ऑफ आवर न्यूमेरिकल मेथड. सो हियर इन दिस लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू सी द लास्ट थ्री मेथड दैट वी आर रिमेनिंग. दीज टू मेथड वी आर ऑलरेडी स्टडीड, दैट इज गॉस एलिमिनेशन मेथड एंड मेथड ऑफ फैक्टराइजेशन, राइट. सो वी हैव टू सी नाउ 3.3, 3.4 एंड 3.5. एंड द पावर मेथड इज नॉट फॉर योर सिलेबस. So here I have given the page number also where it will be available for you approximately in our numerical analysis book. Even I have shared you the notes, the handwritten notes of this, and many more solved examples are also available in these pages. You can go through these pages so that you can understand the third topic. Here also the error in the numerical integration was not for your syllabus, so these points I have covered. Even I have given the page numbers in the, and this is what in the chapter 7 of your numerical analysis book, that is SS Sastri book. In the Sastri book, this unit 4 is a chapter number 7. Okay, and these are the page numbers for the corresponding points, right? And this is chapter number 6, I think so, in the numerical analysis book by SS Sastri, and these are nothing but the page numbers in which this topic you will get. Okay, and there are so many solved example and exercises example for you. So in this lecture we are going to cover, so actually whatever the syllabus I am showing you, this is for the numerical analysis mathematics student syllabus, not for you. The paper name for this is numerical technique, and it is OET paper, it is not SCT. Okay, so I have just make a cross mark which is not for your syllabus. Okay, so actually the syllabus for OET is smaller as compared to the syllabus of numerical analysis for mathematics student. Okay, so let me go through the three points. First we'll see Gauss-Seidel method, Hausdorff method, and symmetric triangular method. Okay, so let us start with the points. Gauss-Seidel method. What is Gauss-Seidel method? Actually, it is a iterative method. Here you can see, if with the help of approximations, we are going to find out a Gauss-Seidel method. I am not going to use a board because many students are commenting in the comment box that it is not visible. So no need to go through the board now, because if it is not visible, we are not going to use a board. In that case, I am going to use this PDF, as it will be just like a PowerPoint presentations to present, right? So here, so we are going to have an approximation. First, we'll go through the approximation. We'll find approximate values of those x1, x2, x3, up to xn. And then next, we will find out the next approximation. That is, if you are finding x1, x2, x3, up to xn, that means we are going to name it as x1 raised to naught, x2 naught, x3 naught, and so on. So these will be the initial approximation, and finally we'll go one by one to reach the correct root or very approximate root or exact root of our, exact solutions of these equations. Okay. So what we are going to have, we are having n equations in n unknown. So we are having n unknowns, x1, x2, x3, up to xn. And these are our constant, and this is nothing but V1, V2, V3. So what we have to do, we have to just, we have to write down first equation in terms of x1 is equal to. If you want to write down this equation in terms of x1 is equal to, the coefficient of x1 should not be 0. Okay. So we have to divide this whole equation by A11 and write the equation in terms of x1 is equals to. What will be the equation? V1 minus A12 x2 minus A13 x3 up to so on minus A1 and xn. And on the next step, you have to divide it by A11. Similarly, you have to write down the second equation. What is our second equation? Now you have to write down the second equation in terms of x2 is equal to, right? So what will be the equation? B2 minus A21 x1 next minus A23 x3 and so on minus A2n xn. Okay. And then you have to divide it by A22. In this way, we have to do this procedure for the last equation also. So what will be this last equation? We have to write down this last equation for xn is equal to. What will be the equation? Ann xn is equal to bn minus an1 x1 minus a12 x2 minus an3 x3 and so on. Okay. And so on, the last term will be an minus 1, an minus 1 minus 1, then xn minus 1. So on the next step, you have to divide the whole equation by ann. Okay. So doing this arrangement, we have got this type of equation. The first equation is written in terms of x1. In the second equation is written in terms of x2. Third equation is written in terms of x3 is equal to. And the last equation is written in terms of xn. Okay, this is what 6.73. So actually this chapter is a chapter number 6 in our SS Sastri book. And you can see the example theory from the book. And it is written very easily. No need to go through your notes also. Okay. So what we have to do now, we have to find out first approximation. So that's why it may be zeroth or first approximation. X1 man, X1 2, X1 n, sorry, X3 a1 and so on, Xn 1. So how to find out these first approximation? What you have to do is, first you have to equate all them to be zero. Okay. This in the first equation, X2, X3 up to Xn, sabhi zero honge. Simply X1 is equal to, we have written, no? So x2 is 0, x3 is 0, and up to so on, xn is 0. We have to assume all the other terms other than x1, we have to assume all them to be 0. If all are 0, what I get the equation? X1 is equal to b1 upon a11. No doubt, if you are going to solve the example at that time, you will get b1 and a11. So after dividing, you can get some number, right? So here you are getting one number, which is x1 is equal to b1 upon a11. Now, if you got this number, you have to put this number x1 is equal to b1 upon a11 in this equation. Okay, x2 is equal to. Here it is b2 upon a22 and what is the next term? Minus a21 upon a22. What is the value of x1 we have got from the first equation is b1 upon a11. Correct? All other we have to assume to be 0. The second equation, we have to assume all other terms to be 0. Correct? So we are assuming this term to be 0. And hence we are getting now the x2 is equals. Okay. So actually this is not an actual value of x2. This is nothing but x1, 1. This is x2, 2. So you will be confused. Here is also x2. Here is also x2. How you are going to assume? So this is actual value and here it is approximate value. Or we may say it is first approximation. So these equation we have to write down as x21 is equal to b2 upon a22, a21 upon a22, x1 is equals to b1 upon a11. And these term from here onwards, we are going to keep it as a 0, right? And the next step, what you have to do for the third equation, this will be nothing but x3 raised to 1. Here it will be 1. So what will be the equation? These term as it is, this x1 we have already got b1 upon a11. X value of x2 we have got from the second equation, that we have to write down. As they are not we are not knowing numbers now, that will be somewhat difficult to write down this equation. But if you know values of a11, a12 and so on, b1, b2 and so on, so you can get the value of x3 very easily, right? All the remaining terms we have to assume to be 0. Okay, so in this way you can go for the last equation xn raised to 1, in which you have all the values except xn minus 1. And hence we can write down this equation as, now you can have x11, x1, the first approximation of unknown by substituting on the right side of 6.73, we can get the second approximations. Okay. So hence, after getting the second approximation, what will be the second approximations? These are our second approximation, which we have written with the help of first approximations. And in this way, we can go for n plus 1th approximations. So you can have this n plus 1th approximation, which we have got from the xnth approximation, nth approximation. So hence we have to follow the procedure in such a way that you can have, in this equation 6.73, we have substituted the first approximation to the right side of the equation, and then we have got the second approximation, and we have denoted them x in this way. Next we have got the third approximation, and then in this manner we can complete our first stage of iteration. Okay, so in this way we can complete a Iteration processor, and then we can say this is what. Now let us go for the now you can have the here the Gauss-Seidel method converges twice as fast as Jacobi's method. No, actually it is not for Jacobi's method is not for your syllabus, but you can consider this statement as it may be for MCQ. So here we have this four equation in four unknown. We have to solve it by using Gauss-Seidel method. Okay. So here the equation is written now in terms of x1 is equal to. So you have to divide the first equation by 10. Dividing the first equation by 10 and writing is x1 is equal to. Divide the second equation by coefficient of x2, that is 10, and divide it in the and write it in the form of x2 is equal to. Divide the third equation by 10, that is coefficient of x3, and write it in terms of x3 is equal to. Similarly, divide the third fourth equation, that is coefficient of x4 is 10, divide it by 10 and then write it in terms of x4 is equal. Right? So after writing, what you have to do, again follow the same procedure. What you have to do, make all the coefficient 0, what you got the value of x1 is 0.3. Next, put the value of x1 is equal to 0.3 here, what you get 0.3 into 0.2, that will be 0.06. Right, here it will be 0.06, this xc x4 will be 0. 0.06 plus 1.56 that and 1.5 that will be 1.56. What you got the first approximation we are getting is value of x3 is 1.56. Okay. Similarly, here we can put 2.7, 0.1 into x1 is nothing but 0.3. Okay. So what do you get? It is 0.03 plus 0.1 into 1.56. So that value will be 0.156 plus 0.03 plus 2.7. These all three values you have to combine because we got the values of x1 and x2. So in this way, you can get the equation by keeping x4 is 0. And continuing in this way, we got all the values and then we can write the x4. So here the method is shown 0.3, next was 1.56. Next, in this equation, you have to put x1 and x2. You can get the value 2.886. In this similar way, you can get the value of x1. And next, you have to perform the iterations. Okay, what you have to do in the next step, you have to write down the same equation now in with the help of new values of x1, x2, x3. Right? For the new values of x1, x2, x3, write down the same equation. X1 is equal to 0.3 plus 0.2. What is the value of x2 we have got here? 1.56. Okay, so in this way, you have to solve those equations, and here the solved example is also available. Actually, you should not follow the stable method. You can go with the procedure, or in another way, if you want to go through shortcut, you can follow this. Okay, so this is what a Gauss-Seidel method, and it's a example. Now, let me go for the next method, that is Householder's method. What is Householder's method and next is what our Magnin Allison symmetric trigonal matrix. Actually, it is first, no? So let us go for Magnin Allison symmetric trigonal matrix. So what is given to us? Symmetric tridiagonal. Why it is called tridiagonal? Because it has three diagonals. This is our diagonal, this is lower diagonal entries, and these are upper diagonal entries. So these are called super diagonals. Super diagonal means those with entries which are above or and below of the diagonal. Okay, this is diagonal, this is super diagonal. This is the entries which are below the diagonal. So as it is looking like a diagonal, so hence we call it a symmetric tridiagonal matrix. Why it is called symmetric? Because already we are knowing that what is a symmetric matrix, Aij is equal to Aji. So you can see here value of A12 is equal to A21. So here they have not written it as A21. Actually, these two values are equal. Value of A32 is exactly equal to value of A23. This is A23 and this is A32, but they have written it as A23. Why this is so? Because it is symmetric as well as tridiagonal. Why it is called tridiagonal? Because it has three diagonals, right? So we have to find out eigenvalues of symmetric tridiagonal matrix. I hope you have covered this in the linear algebra. So what you have to do, first you have to check whether the matrix is non-zero or zero. So for that, after checking that, we have to write down it is A minus lambda I. What is A minus lambda I? That will be nothing but we have to just subtract by minus lambda times matrix with one entries 100, 010, and 001. Okay, so hence now we can solve this equation for value of a lambda. After solving this equation for value of a lambda and equating it to zero, you can get the value of a lambda. After getting the value of lambda, you have to do the procedure. Okay. So next is what? Householder's method in our point. So eigenvalues problem for symmetric diagonal matrix you have already studied. So next is the method of householder's method, in which a matrix is given to us. That is, let A be the matrix with the entries A11, A12, A13, A12. As it is also, it should be also symmetric matrix. This is A21, but these entries are equal. A13 is equal to A31. Here this entry should be A31, but it is A13. This entry should be A32, and this is exactly equal to value of A23. Okay? So we are having one symmetric matrix, and then we have to solve the example, or we have to find the eigenvalues by using householder's method. So for that, we have to do one thing, that we have to find out a matrix P1 in such a way that this matrix P1 satisfy the condition P1AP1. That means if you multiply P1, that is post multiply and pre multiply for A, you should get a symmetric tridiagonal matrix. That means we have to reduce a matrix A in the form of symmetric tridiagonal matrix. On the condition, it should be orthogonal. We have to find out our symmetric orthogonal matrix P1 in such a way that it must satisfy the condition P1AP1 is equals to this condition. Okay. Now, what these primes denote, that means elements have been changed, but A11 is not changed. So we have got all the other elements are changed. So what is P1? We have to find out P1 as a real symmetric orthogonal matrix. Okay. So what is the condition for P1? Householder's, in the householder method, it is given that I minus 2VVP. I is already known to you. What is I? I is identity matrix. That is, first row is 100, second is 010, and third row is 001. Minus 2 times VV transpose. What is V? V is nothing but we are having one row matrix. V0, V2, V3 is a transpose. On the condition, what is the condition for this? VV transpose should be equal to 1. Hence, it will, this P1 will become the real symmetric orthogonal matrix. What is the meaning of orthogonal matrix? I don't know exactly you are knowing or not, but you should search for orthogonal matrix, and then you will get a matrix P1 is equals to, what will be P1? 1 minus 2 times VV transpose. You have to write down V as well as V transpose, and the condition VV transpose should be equal to 1. After multiplying this, first write the identity matrix here, minus 2 times V. What is V? V is nothing but a column matrix, 0, V2, V3. Okay, next is, here it is, V transpose. No? What is V transpose? 0, V2, V3. So here also we will got one 3 cross 3 matrix. So here is 3 cross 3, this is also 3 cross 3. Why it is 3 cross 3? Because V is nothing but column matrix 1 cross 3. V is 3 cross 1 and V transpose is 1 cross 3. Okay, so 1 is equal. So you will get a product of V transpose that will be equal to 3 by 3 matrix. Okay, so this is also 3 by 3 matrix with minus 2, and I is 3 cross 3 identity matrix. So do the addition, multiplication, and you will get this P1. Okay. After getting this, what you have to do is, we are provided that V2 square plus V3 square is equals to 1. Why this? So because V transpose V is equal to 1. So just multiply this V transpose with V. Here there is somewhat confusion, because you may be confused. Here it is V transpose, here it is V transpose V. On the condition, we have to check, or we have to take V in such a way that V transpose V should be equal to 1. So with the help of this condition, we can have V2 square plus V3 square is equal to 1. And now what will be P1 transpose? Because we have to check whether it is a orthogonal matrix. So after changing this, we get this. So after having A P1, okay, we have got now value of P1. Now just multiply P1 to our matrix A. Okay, and pre multiply, post multiply. Multiply this matrix A both side by P1 and both side, that is pre and post multiply. AP1 and this is P1 AP1. That is this multiplication you can write down, or if you are noting all the values, it will be good. Okay, after getting all those values, these are nothing but the values of those prime that here we have written. That is P1 AP1 is nothing but these values. A11 is as it is, all other values have changed. So here you can get the value of this. After getting values of these, you have to write down the matrix. Okay. So hence, in this way, we have covered our all the 3 points. If you want to solve the example, you can go and search in YouTube. Actually 80% syllabus is covered by me, and it is compulsory to cover the 80% syllabus for teachers. So I have covered 80% syllabus. I am not getting the response from you in the last few days because I have taken one live lecture, only one or two students were there and they also left after some time. So that's why I am not interested in much. So you have to go through the example for this. So I have covered all the first, second and fourth chapter very nicely. For the third chapter, you have to go in detail. I have told you to solve the examples of Simpson's one-third rule. Even for all the assignment, you have to upload on a Google Classroom that I have created. Tell your friends to join the Google Classroom. Attend all the lectures. I have shared the link of my YouTube channel where you have to see only those lectures, which is numerical technique or OET lecture, numerical technique lecture. This type of a title will be there. So you have to go through this, and here in this lecture we have covered Gauss-Seidel, Hausdorff and symmetric tridiagonal matrix. All the notes of this will be available here. Power method is not for your syllabus. So all the syllabus we have covered. So if you are having still, if you have any type of a doubt, and if you are interested, then we can go with one live lecture in which you can ask many type of a doubt that you have. You have to go through the examples for this. Search on a Google, search on a YouTube. They will provide you the example. An example is not a much big thing to solve. So solve all the examples of these three methods the theory of these methods I have taken. For Gauss-Seidel, I have taken the example also. For Hausdorff and symmetric tridiagonal, you have to go through the examples, solve the example. And let us go what we have seen up to now. What was our topic? First topic is error in numerical calculation, in which we have seen what are the numbers, what is approximations, what is error, what are the types of error. Then we have written general error formula, error in series approximation. Then we have gone for iteration method and rate of convergence. We have seen first method, that is bisection method, and it's the rate of convergence, method of false position, and it's the rate of convergence. This iteration method is nothing but bisection method. Secant method and rate of convergence, Newton Raphson method, and it's the rate of convergence. These all things we have covered in the first topic, and you have given the internal test also. I hope you are understanding, but many student doesn't get a good marks. All the students get the marks 10 or less than 10. Okay, I will share the sheet of that marks you have got. So I am giving one homework for you, that is instead of saying homework, I will say that if you are ready to share your marks with your friends, I will share this on Google Classroom, the first internal marks. Then we have got for the unit 2, what is the unit 2? Interpolation and numerical differentiation. So in this we have seen firstly Lagrange's interpolation, then we have seen finite differences, that is forward, backward, central difference, symbolic relations. These relation you must remember. There are many MCQ can be possible as you are going to appear for MCQ exam. Many MCQ will be possible from this. Newton's formula for interpolation, we have seen Lagrange's interpolation, divided difference formula, their general formula. We have seen many examples we have solved. What was the third topic we have covered? Actually, this is not in the sequence I have shown. So numerical integration is a fourth topic in which we have seen general integration formula, then trapezoidal rule. If I put n equal to 1 in the general integration, that is a trapezoidal rule. If I put n equal to 2 in the general integration, then it is one Simpson one third rule, or it is called simply Simpson's rule. And if I put n equal to 2 in the general integration formula, then it will be Simpson's 3/8 rule. And after that, solutions of differential equation by Taylor series. We have seen there are two methods, that is Euler's method and Euler's modified method. And we have seen direct substitution method, that is series method. So many examples I have told you to solve from the exercises. And even some example I have covered in the recorded lecture also. So you have to solve the example from there. And even in the notes that I have showed, there are many solved examples are also available. So go through that. You can search on Google examples of Simpson method, or you can go for examples of Euler's method, Euler's modified method. And the unit 3, in the unit 3, we have seen Gauss elimination method that I have given in detail. And the next one is LU decomposition that we have studied. In this lecture, we have studied Gauss-Seidel method and its example Haushalter method we have seen. Next, we have seen symmetric triangular matrix, and this is not for your syllabus, our method. So you can go for the syllabus because I have covered all the three chapter very nicely. We have for unit 3, you have to study. Even I have taken for 3 points, I have covered very nicely. So go through the points, complete your syllabus. Thank you. Then if you have a doubt, you can ask.